Welcome. Welcome. It is good to be with you all. Thanks for coming and being with us. If you haven't yet received, let me see if I can do this. If you haven't yet received your giving letter for the year, see me. I probably have it. I'm trying to get to everybody that I see. That includes y'all, anybody online. If you haven't received yours yet, reach out to me. I'll get it to you. We're getting those out ASAP. So, anything else along those lines? Sorry, I was just printing some things out, so let me get back to where I need to be. Okay, here we go. So, what's today? It's not even Super Bowl Sunday. Like, it's not even, anyways. It's good to have you. Those that show up, it's really great. And for those of you maybe that are online or listening later, just know this. We miss you when you're not here. We find it important to gather together. We find it important to be together, to be face to face. We know that the online thing is great opportunity when you can't make it, when you're sick or whatever. But when you're not, it's a deal. It's a deal when you can be in the physical presence of your friends and those who we call family. So anyways, just know that you're missed when you're not here. We love it when you show up. And I know that's, I'll stop there. But come when you can. Okay. This morning, we're continuing in this question, these two questions. What do you want me to know? What do you want me to do? We're continuing in this line of thread. And the idea, too, is that we're learning to listen. And so as you hear this invocation, understand that's still where we're at. We're still practicing, maybe, participating in this, might you call a discipline of listening for the Lord. Listening for his voice. He is indeed speaking in this life and in this world. And so for us to take moments to pause and listen and pay attention to what it is that he's doing in and amongst us becomes important. So hear this invocation, and that is where we'll continue for this Sunday morning. Almighty God, you created us to rest in your peace. May we be still and know that you are God. Help us to hear your voice. You are very present. You are our very present help in times of trouble. Help us to hear your voice and know your presence among us. O God, remind us that you are the ruler of the world. And as we wait in silent awe, listening for your kingdom to arrive in its fullness, inspire us to be harbingers of your peaceable kingdom, living lives that hear your voice, and finding ways to participate in the mending of your world. Amen. Amen. Kristen. Yay.
Yay. Good morning. Good morning. How are you? Okay, we have some things to celebrate this morning, so maybe that'll wake you up. Number one, Girl Scout cookies are here. Praise Jesus' holy name. Am I right? I highly recommend tag-alongs. I got myself two boxes, and that should last me the week. So highly recommend. I think Abby has a goal of, is it 12 million boxes to sell? Oh, 1,000. Well, that should be pretty doable. They brought some today if you've placed an order with them. I heard their car is also stuffed full. They have more. And when that runs out, there's more where that came from. So lots of Girl Scout cookies to go. Am I lying? Am I telling the truth? I'm right? Yeah, I'm right. Okay. We got lots of Girl Scout cookies. See Abby Jacobson. You can Venmo. You can write a check. You can bring cash. But you can't do an IOU. You don't get the cookies till you pay. Okay? That's the deal. Okay. That's what we're celebrating, number one. Did we celebrate? Girl Scout cookies. Yes, we didn't celebrate. Amen. Okay. The second. God is faithful. Yeah, we're celebrating God is faithful, as we always are. But today we put money behind it. Amen. That's from Pastor Cherie. Yes, I am not authorized to do this, but I'm going to go ahead and do it. I'm going to just go ahead and take over this announcement for youth ministry. So you can cross this off your list. Our Valentine's fundraiser is for NYC to raise money for our students to be able to go. It is a week from Tuesday. Yes. Do you guys have big Valentine's plans? You excited? Guys, what's going on? Abby, you should sell some coffee to go with your Girl Scout cookies. We have this fundraiser opportunity for you to bring your children, for your friends to bring their children, for your enemies to bring their children, whoever has kids, whoever needs a babysitter for Valentine's Day. We are offering childcare from 5 to 8 p.m. Next Tuesday night here at the church. Students who are very responsible and equipped, as well as four adults, will be there to supervise. They will be fed. They will be entertained. They will have just so much fun, and then they'll go back home to you full of candy. It'll be awesome. And the very exciting piece of this, maybe it's exciting, there's no one signed up yet. So we have so many spots available. I'm serious. If your neighbor has a bunch of kids, send them our way. Like, let's do this. We'll take kids 6 months to 11 years old. It's $12 an hour per kid. Please sign up by next Sunday at noon, okay? Yes? Yes. Next Sunday, February the 12th, at 12 o'clock noon, 12 p.m. in the afternoon, the 12 one. That's when the cutoff ends to sign your kids up, and that's so that we can be available and prepped with all the food and all the things and honestly mentally prepared to watch your children. It's going to be awesome. But if we have no one sign up, obviously we will cancel and we'll let these kids go on their dates, I guess, for Valentine's. So take us up on that. It's going to be a good evening with your kids. Just take advantage of it, even if you don't have Valentine's plans. Go home and take a nap, right? Awesome. All right, Sarah.
All right.
Yes, Sarah!
All right, all right. So a few announcements. First and foremost, this Wednesday, things are back on schedule. Kids are back in school. It's all happening. You guys aren't out till spring break, right? I hate to say that, but right? That's April around here, right? April. Okay. So, March? Oh, March 13th. Some of the parents know on the dime. Okay. So Wednesday, prayer here and also teens here on Wednesday. Also, would love to get the Bronco fans. What are you thinking about the Super Bowl? Who's rooting for the Chiefs? Anybody? Okay, yeah. Okay. I know we are. And Eagles? Nobody? Oh, one? Okay. I've got people that work for me in Pennsylvania, and let me just say, wow. It is Eagle mania. Every call I'm on, they're rooting, and we have to start all of our business calls with Go Eagles and all their fight songs. It's a lot of fun, and they're also wearing all of the green. So anyways, Chiefs Eagles next Sunday, and the reason that's important is because we will be meeting here next Sunday at 4 o'clock for a Super Bowl party. You can bring friends, bring snacks, bring food to share, but a good time in wrapping up the football season. And no, the Rams aren't in the Super Bowl. Dolphins aren't in the Super Bowl. So I have to say Glovers probably don't care as much. But anyways, still should be a fun game. We'll see. Trying to decide if the Eagles are going to blow the Chiefs out or not. Man, they are the team to beat. And I'm not an Eagles fan, but they are the team to beat this year. Okay, women's Bible study today here. So if you have not come, please feel free to join. It's fairly early in the series, so you will not miss out. So feel free to pop in for that. And then also, we still have meals and gifts for drop-offs for the Ziegler's for Kara. So remember her in prayer as she goes through the journey. We want to be there with her. I will give you a word of warning. I was just telling Alyssa, first of all, I didn't know that that neighborhood went back that far. And it took me forever because the roads aren't great. So I suggest a four-wheel drive, a sled, a snowmobile, something to get back there. But man, the roads were tough. So, but just know Kara's really appreciating that. It's going a long way to help. So thank you for those that have signed up, and thank you for those to continue to sign up. And Sarah, it is great to have you back here with us today. I told her I thought she was looking great, and we've missed you, so it's great to have you back. And I would ask for a prayer request. I had a CT to follow up last week, and I was expecting all things to go great until they don't. So I have another CT scheduled on Thursday of this week, so I would just ask you to pray for me. That's all I can really say right now, because it's a whole bunch of question marks and a whole bunch of unknown, but I know I'm in God's hands, and I know he can heal, so I am very thankful for that. If others of you have prayer requests, please let us know. A lot of sickness going around everywhere, that nasty stomach flu bugs going around, all kinds of stuff. So please, let's continue to pray for each other. And with that, let's stand and greet each other. And it's great to see everyone here today.
Give me peace when I am tossed and fried and lost among the waves. Give me hope when I am in doubt and fears are clouding up my faith. Would you come and move the mountains? 'Cause I'm too weak to climb. Promise that you're with me in this fight. I can't.
Good morning. As you find your places, it's good. good to be back with you again. It was great time last weekend speaking to some people in Spokane in the Northwest District. So I miss being here with you. But this morning, we're going to worship the Lord. We're thankful that he is a good father and that he's faithful and loving. So would you stand with us? Let's sing the song, Be Glad.
Well, it is good to be together and worshiping. And if you haven't noticed, it's Family Sunday. Three cheers for Family Sunday. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Yeah. So it's good to have our friends here, our younger friends, worshiping and honestly leading us to the throne.
That's right.
So I hope that you let them lead us to the throne. We're going to keep singing together. And we're going to continue in worship in a couple different forms. We're going to hear scripture and preaching. And it's all going to sort of inhabit this multi-generational feel, which is who we are as a church, right?
That's right.
Let's praise Jesus together.
There's nothing that our God can't do, amen? Amen. He makes a way in the desert. He leads us to places where we can drink. He's a faithful God. Lift our voices. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word.
Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that he can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside me.
Just one word.
Just one word, and you revive every dream. Faith arise, let all agree, there's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree, there's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe. Jesus, let faith arise, let all agree, there's no power like his power, there's nothing like
you to remain standing as we hear Abby Jacobson come and read scripture this morning. Let's lean into the presence of the Lord through his word.
Then your light will break out like the dawn, and you'll be healed quickly. Your own... Oh, no. Okay. Shout loudly, don't hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their crime, to the house of Jacob their sins. Okay. They seek me day after day, desiring knowledge of my ways, like a nation that acted righteously, that didn't abandon their God. They ask me for righteousness, judgments, wanting to be close to God. Why do we fast and you don't see? Why afflict ourselves and you don't notice? Yet on your fast days, you do whatever you want and oppress all your workers. You quarrel and brawl, and then you fast. You hit each other violently with your fists. You shouldn't fast as you are doing today if you want to make your voice heard on high. Is this the kind of fast I choose? A day of self-affliction, of bending one's head like a reed and of lying down in mourning, clothing in ashes. Is this what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Isn't this the fast I choose? Releasing wicked restraints, untying the ropes of a yoke, setting free the mistreated and breaking every yoke. Isn't it sharing your bread with the hungry and bringing the homeless poor into your house, covering the naked when you see them, and not hiding from your own family? Then your light will break out like the dawn, and you will be healed quickly. Your own righteousness will walk before you, and the Lord's glory will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and God will say, I'm here. If you remove the yoke from among you, the finger pointing, the wicked speech, if you open your heart to the hungry and provide abundantly for those who are afflicted, your light will shine in the darkness, and your gloom will be like the noon. The Lord will guide you continually and provide for you, even in parched places. He will rescue your bones. You will be like a watered garden, like a spring of water that won't run dry. You will rebuild ancient ruins on your account. The foundations of generations past you will restore. You will be called mender of broken walls, restorer of livable streets.
Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Way to be flexible, Abby. That was awesome. You did a great job. I love how our young people lead us into worship. That is one of the reasons we do Family Sunday, is that we as adults need to remember that our kids and our teenagers hear from the Lord, and they are able to lead us well. This morning, let's just take a moment, just real quick, to ask the Lord to move this morning in our own minds and in our own hearts. We just want him to be the one that we're focused on today, the one that we're listening to. And this morning, as we come out of that moment of just asking the Lord, we're going to sing a song that says, your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. So go ahead and take some moments before the Lord.
You have never failed. waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness, I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. I know the promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. Oh, you never fail. Blessed assurance.
Praising
go into the presence of the Lord this morning and pray together as the worship team moves off stage.
Pray with me this morning. God in heaven, we come this morning thankful. Thankful for your presence among us. But God, still yet, we ask that you would indeed reveal yourself to us in new and profound ways. God, that we might hear your voice anew. Fresh, that we might be found caught in your story, that we could sing that this is my story caught up in your story, this one that is redemption and healing, this one that is hope for a world to be redeemed and made whole. God, would you shape us this morning? Would you move in our hearts and our spirits? God, that we would not just be here for another Sunday morning where we do the things. But God, that we would be moved. Our very heart and soul would be awakened to yours. God, I pray that we would have courage. Courage to not only ask these two questions, but to respond well to your answers. God, we submit ourselves to you, to your will, to your goodness. And we ask that you do what you do in us. And God, for those who are looking for more than just those two questions and answers, I pray, God, that you would be particularly close. For those who continue to battle illness, cancer, other medical complications, whatever they may be, God, we ask that your hand would do the miraculous.
Yes, Jesus.
That you would give strength to both body and mind, soul. And God, that your revelation, your coming, your showing up would not just challenge us, but would grace us in powerful ways.
Lord, I love how we heard Abby Jacobson just read scripture of places where we need to recognize that you are the mender of broken places and that, Lord, you call us to be the same. So, Lord, first we just relinquish any rights we have, any plans we have, any control we're holding, any attitudes or motivations that are not honoring to you. And God, we ask that you would move in this congregation. We ask that you would wake us up to your spirit, to your voice and what you're saying. Lord, we're not pretending. We're not putting on a front this morning. We ask that you would move in us, that you would change and transform us. Lord, I ask you'd heal bodies in this place, that are broken and fighting disease and fighting issues internally, physically. I ask you to heal bodies that are fighting things emotionally and mentally and spiritually. God, I ask that you would move mountains, like we just sang. You made a way where there was no way. And we believe that you can do it. Lord, we pray that you would silence cancer. We ask that you would wake up bodies to the way you designed them to work. Lord, we know we live in a broken world. We understand that. And we give you honor for the fact that we have air in our lungs. We give you attention that you are the one who made us. So we honor you, and we understand that there's not always healing on this side, but we ask, Lord, for multiple things of healing. Lord, I ask that you would wake up ears to hear, physically and spiritually. I asked that there would be an end inside us of traumatic things we've experienced. I ask that you would give us hope for today and for a future. Lord, I ask that you would heal broken marriages, heal broken communication, heal the ways in which we navigate life that is not honoring to you. God, make a way where there was no way. Do it again. Thank you for your care and your love. Would you speak through Pastor Kristen this morning as she brings a word on Family Sunday. Open the ears of our children and our teens and adults. Lord, we relinquish any stubbornness before you, or we don't want to hear you. We want to hear you today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Pastor Kristen.
Good morning, friends, again. I just muted myself. There we go. Can you hear me well? I can move this around. Okay. We're going to start with scripture. We're going to move around this morning. It's going to be fun. So just go ahead and brace yourselves. I'm going to hate today. Pastor Kristen's going to make me annoyed. And I hate when she preaches. And then just move on. It's fine. We can all just accept it, and then go forward. So, if you would, to begin with, would you stand with me, if you're able, for the reading of God's Word? We're going to be in Luke chapter 2 today. No, we're not reading about the birth of Jesus. We're just a little bit down from that, starting in verse 22, going all the way to verse 40. I'm reading from the ESV. I'm not sure what they have up there, but follow along with me. Okay. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, Simeon took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, that's us, and for glory to your people, Israel. And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts will be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin and then as a widow until she was 84. She did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who were waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. And again, this is the word of the Lord for us this morning. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Unless you're a kid, if you're a kid or a student or consider yourself a kid, I would love for you to come up here and join me so we can hang out together. I have snacks for you. I have not really games, but activities for you. Hey, we're going to sit. Can you sit in like the, you can sit on the floor if you want, but we're going to take up this row. Awesome. Awesome. Here they come. As promised, I have my special unicorn bucket of Rice Krispie Treats. Praise the Lord. Amen. Would you like a Rice Krispie Treat? Do you want one? Cool. You want to take one down, pass it around? And I also have juice boxes, if you're interested in a juice box. Cool. Yeah, pass it around. Okay. Cool. If there's not a chair, we can like spread into these rows. You can sit on the floor. Whatever works. Solid. Okay, so kids, friends, I have a question for you. What holiday did we just celebrate? Yeah, Christmas. I didn't even have to give you hints. Christmas. What happened at Christmas? Gifts. What else happened at Christmas? Yes, Ashton. Jesus was born. It happens every year. It's very exciting. Jesus was born again this year. Hallelujah. And we celebrated that Jesus came and was born on the earth. So this story, the story I just read, don't worry, I'm going to recap it in case you weren't listening. This story takes place a little bit down the road from Jesus' birth. So Jesus is still a teeny little baby. Did you see a teeny little baby up here earlier? Yeah, I bet he was bigger than that. But he was still tiny, right? He couldn't talk. His mom needed to give him everything he needed. And the only way he could communicate with her was, how do babies communicate? They cry. Sometimes they scream, right? And so little baby Jesus, his parents carried him. Where did they carry him? Do you know? I just read about it. It's okay if you weren't listening. Jerusalem. What was in Jerusalem? Do you know? That's all right. One for one. That's pretty good. They took him to the temple. Do you know what happens at the temple for babies? For Jewish babies? You know what happened to a bunch of you when you were babies? Your parents brought you to church, and they brought you up in front of everybody, and they held you up, kind of like the Lion King, right? And they said, this baby belongs to who? To God. They said, we have this baby. We're doing the hard work. We're paying the bills. But this baby and his or her life belongs to God. And that is a decision that your parents made to honor God's gift of you to them. Did you know that you're a gift? Well, you are. You're a gift to your parents, to me, to us here in the church, to everyone that you encounter. You're a gift from God. And that is a time that your parents said, you know what? We want to recognize Elijah's a gift from God. Abby's a gift from God. Ben's a gift from God. Ashton's a gift from God, right? You're all gifts from God. And so the same thing is happening with Jesus. And it's this really cool story. We don't have a lot of info about Jesus from the night he was born up until he starts his ministry, right? We don't know a lot. We have like a few little things. This is one of those. We also have the time. Do you remember when Jesus was like a little boy? He was about Ashton's age, teaching in the temple. Have you heard that story? Yes. Yes. I know that you have. So we have that story, and we have this one that we're on today. So Jesus is still a baby. So he's the star of the show, but he doesn't actually say anything in this, right? His parents take this trip. They didn't have cars, just like Jesus' birth, right? So they probably came in on that same donkey, rode back up into Jerusalem, and who do they meet? This super old dude named Simeon. Simeon is the coolest, okay? Let me just go ahead and tell you. Have you ever met like a super cool old dude? I have. No offense, old dudes. They just know a lot, okay? They've lived a lot of life. They have a lot of good stories. If you have the opportunity to make friends with an old dude that maybe your parents are also friends with, it's a good time. Hear their stories, learn from them. Simeon's one of these guys, okay? Simeon has been around for a while. By the way, can you say Simeon? There's some hard names in the Bible, but Simeon's not really one of them. So Simeon is in the temple waiting for baby Jesus. Do you think he knew baby Jesus was coming?
Yeah, he knew? Oh, all right. So, Simeon is waiting on them. They roll up, right? They've got baby Jesus. They're there to do two things. Number one, Mary. Who's Mary?
Jesus' mother,
exactly. Yes, thank you. Mary is there to be purified or cleansed, if you will, because there was this rough rule back then, back in the day, that women became unclean when they had given birth. Rude, first of all. Just rude. But it is what it is. So women had been considered unclean because they hadn't figured out science yet and how to, you know, all of that. So God was like, I'll make a way. We'll clean it all up. So you're like, it's fine. We can talk to women again. So she has to come into the temple, and we're going to do this purification ritual. And then she'll be holy again, basically, in the sight of God, and can continue moving on about her life, then raising her kids, all of those good things. Doesn't that sound like a silly little ritual? It kind of does. But we don't understand it, but it is the way that things were back then, right? So they're showing up so that Mary can be purified, and also so that Jesus can be Lion King, right? Jesus can be raised and dedicated to God, which is what Simeon is going to do. And so they show up. And back in the day of the Israelites, what did they have to do in order to, like, earn God's favor, in order to talk to God? They needed to present some animals. Is that right? What was that called when they brought animals before God? A sacrifice. Thank you, Mr. Milt. They bring a sacrifice. And now Joseph and Mary are poor. I don't know if you've ever been poor. Probably not. Congratulations. But they brought some of the, like, cheapest, most affordable animals. Like when your parents say, we're going to McDonald's, but all of you are splitting one cheeseburger. These are rough days, okay? But it's important for you to eat. It's important for them to present a sacrifice to God. So they bring some doves that are not expensive, but they'll get the job done, right? Because they're like, we know, because an angel told us, this is God we're carrying, right? This is God's son. So we better go through this and actually bring the doves. So we're going to do that. So we present that to God so that God smiles on the whole thing, right? And that's how the Israelites interacted with God back in the day, until Jesus came and mixed it all up, right? And now we get to just talk to Jesus. Awesome. Okay, so Jesus is dedicated. They meet Simeon. What does Simeon do? Simeon takes the baby, gets to hold baby Jesus. Oh my goodness. Have any of you ever held a baby? Most of you, I would imagine, have held a baby. I know you've held a baby. And Simeon gets to hold baby Jesus, and he gets to look into his face. God promised Simeon, maybe when he was as little as you, I don't know, that he would get to see the face of the one who would save the world, right? That's Jesus. So he's getting to hold baby Jesus, and I imagine Simeon, he's been waiting for this day his whole life, because if you'll recall, he's an old dude, and he has been waiting and waiting and waiting, and this baby shows up, and he just zeroes in, and he's like, that's the one, and he gets placed in his arms, and he's like, this is the Messiah, right? And he gets to speak this blessing over Jesus. Oh my goodness. I'm like brought to tears over it. How special it must have been to get to hold Jesus. And Simeon says, I'm not going to get to see what's going to happen. I know. I'm at the end of my days. And he literally says to God, God, I can die now. I can pass away because you have fulfilled your promise to me. This is the baby that will bring hope and light to the Gentiles. Do you know who the Gentiles are? Not the Jews. Are we Jews? No. We're Gentiles. That means we shouldn't have had a chance. We were outsiders. Jesus is the only one that made a way for us. And Simeon says, man, I don't understand it because those Gentiles are some dirty folks. But this baby is going to make a way. And he's excited about it. And I believe, I think he speaks maybe with hushed tones. But have your parents, this would happen to me. My mother was a yeller, but my dad, he would get down on your level and he would speak in a very calm voice. And you knew you were in a lot of trouble. When he spoke in a quiet voice, it carried as much weight, if not more, as if he were yelling. And I don't think Simeon, now Jesus isn't in trouble, but I don't think he needs to yell about what's happening. I think he's speaking very intentionally, calmly, with great power.
over what is happening here, right? Can you picture this in your head? Old dude holding baby Jesus. Joseph and Mary are standing there like, yeah, we're doing it. We had baby Jesus. That's God right there. Like, we're doing the thing. And God smiles down and they're like, okay. And then Simeon speaks some really hard words to them. And he says, like, they know already, right? Mary, she knows in some way, maybe not in all the specifics, but she knows who Jesus is. And she knows, I'm going to have to watch my son die, probably. And Simeon says, like, Jesus is, he's going to do all these great things. He's gonna reveal light, and he's going to bring hope. But he's also going to kind of reveal inner thoughts of people and be a little bit divisive and call people to be better and reveal maybe what it is that they're thinking about each other and what it is they think about the world and rework the way that we do things. And then he says to Mary, a sword is going to pierce your own heart. Now, do you think that means that Simeon's like, here's Jesus' sword. He's just going to stab you right through the heart. Did that happen? No. He means in like a figurative way. Like, it will be as if a sword has cut through your heart because you will be so badly hurt by what happens to this little boy that you love. You get to bear this joy and this pain of raising your little boy who will do such good, who will be light, will be salvation, but it's going to come at a price. And Simeon's like, we don't need to get too far into that, but it is going to happen. And so he speaks this over Jesus. And then there's this other woman there, and she shows up, and her name is Anna. Can you say Anna? Yeah. She shows up, and she is what is called a prophetess. Do you know what a prophet is? Yeah. This is the girl version of that. So she shows up, and she says similar things. She, like, speaks blessing over this baby. And she speaks of the glory of God coming to earth finally, recognizing, like, when this baby shows up, Anna's like, ooh, that's the one. So in this busy temple, if you can imagine, the temple in these days is super busy. It's like the Starbucks, basically. I don't think they had coffee, but it was like whatever their equivalent was. And people are like hanging out, and they're being together, and they're coming to do their worship, and they're coming to bring their sacrifice, and it's like the center of town, and so everybody sees everybody at the temple, on the way to the temple, coming out of the temple, that kind of thing, right? And so Anna, in the midst of this crowd, both Anna and Simeon, maybe they're on other corners, that's how I imagine it, they're like, Anna's over there, Simeon's over there, Joseph and Mary come walking up this way, and they're like looking around like, now what do? We got to the temple, and they both make a beeline for Jesus, because Simeon's like, that's God, and Anna's like, that's the Messiah, we know about this, right? So, these super, super cool people, Simeon, we've talked about, and Anna is a girl, awesome, and she has been a widow for like ever. This sad story. She gets married, probably pretty young, because that's how it worked back then. Then her husband dies after they've been married for 7 years. That is not in the plan. Don't go dying, Dave. And then she doesn't remarry, and she just keeps living by herself, but she chooses to be in the temple every day. She didn't leave the temple. That's what the scripture says. And she spent all day, every day, worshiping God, praising God. I imagine she took a nap here and there because God, like, understands that kind of stuff. But this woman has spent years, decades in the temple waiting for this baby, just like Simeon. And so they finally get to see this baby. And you can just imagine, like, the relief that they felt of, like, oh, he's here. Our people will be saved. We can die. What a feeling. Can't imagine. Okay, so all of this is happening because the Spirit of God is on Simeon and the Spirit of God is on Anna, right? That's what Scripture says. So today we're going to talk about the Spirit. Scripture says that Simeon was righteous and devout. What does it mean to be righteous? Holy. It means to be holy. Walking with God, walking rightly with God, okay? So Simeon was righteous. He was devout. That means he was like committed, like he was in it. He was not going to back away from his role in worshiping God and serving God for anything, no matter what good, like, buffet there was down the street, no matter what new version of a video game came out. I can't think of anything. And the Holy Spirit was on him. And the Holy Spirit had revealed to Simeon that he would not die before seeing the Messiah, right? He was moved by the Spirit of God to go into the temple courts where he was able to consecrate Jesus back to God. But how did he know? Right? Like, how did Simeon know this is where you need to be? Like, specifically on this day, make sure you're not taking a nap. Like, you think God kind of came over the loudspeaker and was like, yo, Simeon, 9 a.m. Thursday, be there. Be in, like, the southeast corner. Be looking in the middle, like, right around, like, 9, 10. Jesus is going to roll up. Do you think that's what happened? You do? I think you're crazy. I don't think that's what happened, mostly because they didn't have loudspeakers. You think he, like, texted him and was like, reminder, 9 a.m. Thursday, Jesus is coming. Like, how could he be sure then? And maybe if he even, like, had this, like, feeling within him, how could he be sure that it was the Holy Spirit telling him? Like, what if he was just like, nah, that's like my internal clock. I could totally sleep till 10. There's no need. I would love to sleep till 10. How could he be sure that it was really the Holy Spirit telling him what to do? How did he know that he was supposed to be in the temple to meet Jesus? And then when he saw Jesus, how did he even know that's him? That's the one I've been waiting for. And with the other ones, like with Anna, we know that the Holy Spirit was on her. How did she know? The same things. We know that the Holy Spirit conceived Jesus in Mary, right? We've heard that story at Christmas. How did she know that what she was hearing from the angel was true, that what was happening within her was truly of God and of the Holy Spirit? How do you think that they knew? Yeah, Ashton. A gut feeling? I'm with you there. I think you're on the right track. We hear this question a lot. Maybe you asked this question before. I've asked this question before. How do we hear God's voice? Or how do we know that it is God speaking to us or the Holy Spirit speaking to us? I'd like to hear this question. It's intimidating, but I like to hear it because it usually stems from like this innate desire to truly be in communication with God. And I think that's an awesome starting place. For someone to come to you and to say, I want to learn how to hear God's voice. That's exciting. If somebody ever comes to you and does that, don't you dare say, well, I guess read your Bible and like figure it out. You just know, or things like that. No, like that's a mind that's like, come on. Like, help me tap into this. I want to hear from God. I want to communicate with God. And that's a really, really special thing. But sadly, I can't give you a step-by-step, like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are the things that you do to, like, tune into that radio frequency of God, like, constantly communicating with us. I'm sorry, that's not how it works. At least that I'm aware of. I got a degree, and they didn't give me that 5-step program. So either I went to the wrong university, or it doesn't exist. And I can't just give you, like, these are the things you do, these are the things you say, this is, like, where you need to be, this is the time of day that you do it in order for it to work, because it's not magic like that. It's not like we just wait for the stars to align and then, like, we can hear God suddenly, like, oh, our ears are open and we can, like, hear what's happening in heaven. I think it might be better to ask the question of ourselves when we're teaching our kids. When we're guiding anyone, maybe we're mentoring, maybe the better question to ask is, how do I cultivate an environment where I am in an intimate relationship with Christ in which I'm communicating to him and receiving communication from him? So the better question then is, how do I get to that place where I'm in that kind of relationship that I can hear what it is God is sharing with me and what God is trying to say to me? I am, if you didn't know, a family pastor. Fun fact. I've almost been here a year, by the way. Wild. Yeah, crazy. I am a family pastor, and so it's my job and it's my call during this season to focus on the discipleship of you guys, little people, taller little people, and their families, and to kind of walk alongside you guys to work on discipleship. What does discipleship mean? What does it mean to be a disciple? Ashton. A follower of Jesus, yes. like a serious follower. Like not just, yeah, I believe in Jesus, but like, I'm doing this. I'm in it. There were 12 disciples, yes, that were like highlighted in scripture. A little bit later in Luke, you can start reading about them. And it's like my job to focus on that for you guys and to maybe help parents to like do that at home. Because guess what? You and me and your parents all need more than just one service a week to learn about Jesus. To actually be a follower of Jesus, we gotta spend a little bit more time with him than like an hour and a half every week, right? Even if you're a student, you're like, well, I come to youth group. Or you're an adult and you're like, I come to Bible study. You need more than that, right? And so that's our role here as pastors, is to help you walk through this discipleship journey where you say, man, I don't know what to do when I walk out of these doors. I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to disciple my kids. That's what we're doing together. So today, parents, adults, older friends, we're going to put on our kid caps. Go ahead, put on your, go ahead. I told you you'd hate today. But I want to see you put it on. Put the kid cap on your head. Amazing. Okay, like four of you did it, but that's fine. Okay, so we're going to put some kid caps on this morning because the way that God speaks to children is the way that God desires to relate to all of us. And if you don't agree with me, I'm going to point you to some scripture. Let's go. Okay, so much later in the book of Luke, like much later, like Jesus is like 30, okay? Whoa, old. I'm not even 30. Jesus is old, and he is trying to do his job. What's Jesus' job when he's an adult?
To provide top bread to everybody.
Okay, how does he protect us? He teaches us the right things to do, yeah? Say yeah. He did die on the cross. So not yet has he died on the cross. He is in this process of teaching us how to live, like Aaron said. So he is trying to teach and trying to do his job, and there's these pesky kids all around. And the disciples are like, got it. We'll take care of this. The disciples are like, get out of here. Like, you're too close to Jesus. Go away. Go find your parents. Go find a game to play. Go find something else to do. You're bothering us. And what does Jesus say? Does anybody know? Do any of you know? Yeah, let them come. Let them come. They're fine. Why does he say that? He says for or because. Why? Yeah, the kingdom of heaven is theirs. They own the kingdom of heaven. They already have it. These things that you guys are trying to get, they got it. They got the answer. So let them come because they're already tapped in. They're here. They're here, right? Do you know what that means for you? I know you weren't there that day, but do you know what that means for you? The kingdom of heaven is yours. Somebody say, whoa. Like heaven, you know heaven we talk about, right? Like where God lives, like where we will get to see Jesus forever and ever and ever. That's already yours. It belongs to you. You have access to it. Whoa. Craziness. Jesus himself said that. That means it's true. Right? Amen. Believe it. Okay. So Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is yours. And then he even goes on to say, if you want to get into the kingdom of heaven, you should be more like the kids. You need to have faith more like the kids because you're overthinking things and you're getting confused and you're focused on the wrong stuff. Let's take a lesson from these guys. Let them come up here and eat their Rice Krispie treats and get everything sticky, it's fine. Because the kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Right? Yeah. And that means that the kingdom of heaven is just as accessible to kids as it is to adults. And the adults need to become a little bit more like the kids. Oh, right, that's my kind of sermon, right? Can you imagine if your parents acted like you for a day? Does that sound like the most fun day ever or what? Right? And like the things that maybe, do you ever try to like tell your parents something and they're just not getting it? Like, that's not what I'm saying. You don't understand. Oh, you're so dumb, right? Like, come on. Dumb's not a nice word. Don't ever say that to your parents. Maybe if our parents acted like us for a day, they would finally begin to understand what we're trying to communicate with them, right? Wouldn't that be wild? I'm not going to give you that as a homework assignment, but maybe think about it. Okay. So, as parents, as friends, as mentors, as leaders, as adults who are ourselves questioning how do we hear God's voice, we gotta recognize maybe these kids have the key. Because they were created to know God and to hear God's voice. So, kids, question for you. What are some things that God wants us to know? Elijah. Okay, yeah, he wants us to be good and loving towards him, absolutely. That God loves us no matter what. Someone was at VBS. I know, you think it's next year. Show up, because here we are, what, 5 months later, 6 months later, still got it. That God loves us no matter what. That's something God absolutely wants us to know. What else does God want us to know? Ashton. Oh, yeah, that's good. To not be a minimalist when it comes to God. Okay, what are some things that God might want us to do? Disciple others. Disciple others. Ooh, what else? Ashton. Love everyone. Love everyone. What else does God want us to do? Those are two really big ones. If that's all we got today, that's okay. Because I'll tell you right now, I'm blown away. We already know so much about God, and you guys haven't even been to college yet. What? None of you have even graduated high school. Half of you haven't even been to high school. More than half of you haven't been to high school. And you know so much about God already. Are you Bible scholars? Maybe. No, you're not. I've seen how you spend your free time. You're not a Bible scholar. And that's okay. Because your heart is already in tune with what it is that God desires for us to, what we should know and what we should do. Yeah? Wild. I know that you don't feel like this is very exciting, but it is. For you to just already know those things, because we're already learning so much about the character of God by hearing stories about who he is, by learning scripture and memorizing it so that it's written on our hearts. By coming to church, by participating in singing, by being up here and actually listening to what I'm saying to you. You're doing amazingly, by the way. All of these things are helping you to learn about who God is so that you can answer those questions like, well, what is it God wants us to know? What is it God wants us to do? Okay, well, this is what I know about God. So here's a start, right? What are some ways that God speaks to us? Ashton. In our thoughts? Absolutely. Yeah. Does he speak to us then through prayer as well? Yes. Ashton? Action, okay. Through other people. When you've been outside, maybe you've gone hiking. We have some beautiful mountains here in Colorado. Have you ever like looked around you and been like, wow, God is so cool. God made all of this amazing. Have you ever had that thought? You should, if you haven't. God can speak to us through nature. God can speak to us through dreams. I know, wild. God can speak to us through visions, which are a lot like dreams, but maybe you're awake while it happens. God can speak to us through other people, through prayer, through scripture, yeah, through God's word. Can that happen? Am I doing something wrong? We're good? Okay. Yeah, through music? Absolutely. God can speak to us through so many ways, like so many, not just a loudspeaker, right? Like Simeon probably didn't have. So Simeon might have had a lot of possible ways that God spoke to him and shared this message, right? So when you're walking with the Spirit, when you're learning about the Spirit and you're spending time with the Spirit of God every day, you get to know the Spirit pretty well. Makes sense, right? Yeah. If I came to you and I said, hey, Ashton, your mom called me and told me that she wants you to walk home today from church all by yourself. She'll meet you there. Don't worry about it. Don't try to call her because, like, she's busy. But, like, just walk, like, especially take I-25. Like, just walk it and eventually you'll get there. Do you think I'm telling the truth that your mom really told me to tell you that? Do you think? No. Why? Why would your mom not tell you that? And why would you not believe me? because she loves you, maybe, and doesn't want you to die? Yeah, that makes sense. And has your mom ever asked you to walk home from church by yourself in February? Also, you're, what, 12? You could get lost. Do you know the way home from here, walking?
No.
You don't have Google Maps. There's no phone. I forgot that little rule. Yeah, right? And he's like, that doesn't sound like my mom, right? Pastor Chris, you spend a lot of time with Pastor Cherie, right? Yes? Okay, so if someone called you and was like, hey, is this Pastor Chris? And you said, yes. Then they said, your wife wanted me to tell you she's on her way home. Her phone's dead. But she's really hungry, so she's just going to stop at the bakery and get like a bunch of bread and just eat it on her way home to you, but she'll be there soon. What would you think about that?
Yeah,
so he's like, you have my wife in captivity or something, because that does not sound like my wife, because I know my wife. I know she's very allergic to bread. What a problem. We need to pray for Pastor Cherie, absolutely. And so Pastor Chris, because he spends time with her, Ashton, because he spent a lot of time with his mom, they know this does not sound like those guys, right? These messages are a little phony. Do you know what phony means? Right. Silliness.
Awkward.
Ridiculous. Lies. Because that's not these people, right? Okay. I'm gonna do another little quick like way of showing this to you. Can I have three women volunteer to come up? Sarah, thanks for raising your hand. Amazing. I need two more. Casey, thanks. And Sherry, will you come? Okay, great. I'm going to use this mic if that's all right. And then I need Erin. Will you volunteer with me? With your mom? Amazing. Okay, can you stand right here? Up real close. Right there. Just real close to your friends there. Face the back. Don't look back here or it doesn't work. All right, ladies, come up here, please. Maybe come up on the steps so Erin can't see you. We're going to mix ourselves up. Mixy, mixy, mixy. They're so mixed, Erin. You don't know who's standing where. Okay. Now, I need each of you to speak three words. Nothing else. Say, I am Erin's mom. Okay? So first, one person's going to say, I am Erin's mom. The next person's going to say, I am Erin's mom. The next person's going to say, I am Erin's mom. Okay? Are you ready, Erin, to hear this? Don't turn around, okay? All right, you go first, please.
I am Erin's mom. I am Erin's mom.
I am Erin's mom.
All right, Erin, was number one your mom? No. Was number two your mom? Yeah. Was number three your mom? No. Good job, everyone. Thanks so much. Erin, how did you know that was your mom?
You
recognized her voice? Are you sure? Like, you couldn't see her. How did you know it was her voice? That's a hard one to answer, isn't it? How'd you know? Is it just because of the way it sounds?
Uh-huh.
It just sounds like mom, right? Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much, Erin. Have a seat. Everyone give Erin a round of applause and our friends for joining us. I'm sure it's not a big jump to see where we're going here, right? When Simeon was walking with the Spirit, he knew that he had to go to the temple. How did he know? He knew the Spirit's voice because of the way it sounded. Maybe it was audible. Maybe there was a loudspeaker, and it was like, Simeon, to the temple court today, 9 a.m. This is God. Maybe that happened. I doubt it. Could have happened, though, right? Maybe Simeon had a dream. Maybe he just had a feeling in his heart. Maybe he saw it written down one day. Maybe a notification popped up on his phone. I don't know. But I know that however it happened, Simeon could trust it because he just knew what the Spirit was like when the Spirit was talking to him. But he could trust the voice because it sounded like God. When we are learning to hear God's voice, here's something you need to know. God will never say anything out of character for God. So right now you're thinking like, oh, like my thoughts are God's voice. Sometimes Not always, right? Not everything we think is from God. Sometimes it's original thought, just from us. Sometimes it's from somebody who's really, really not God, trying to mess us up and confuse us and call us to do things that aren't quite right. So we know God loves everyone, right? God loves everyone, Aaron? Is it no matter what, exactly. God loves everyone no matter what. So if you were to have a feeling or to have a dream after maybe someone was really rude to you, and your feeling says, you know what, I need to go back to them and give them some of the sass that they gave me so that they know how it feels. Now, maybe that's going to put them in their place, but do you think that thought is from God? Why? Yeah, God would never ask you to be rude to someone. He just won't. We might want to. They might deserve it. But that's kind of how God operates, is I know that's what they deserve, and it kind of sucks that we have to be this way, but we're going to be better than that. God will never ask you to do something that is out of God's character. And if God is asking us to love everyone, to treat everyone with love and with respect, he will never ask you then to go give someone a dish of their own medicine, right? A taste of their own medicine. Before we can say, though, before we can ever say, that doesn't sound like something God would say, we have to know what does sound like something God would say. It's kind of a messy little, like, oh, before we do that, we got to do this. And it all starts with, we have to spend time with God knowing God. Okay, so how can we know what God is like? How do we learn about God? Okay, experiences. What else? Maybe coming to kids' church every week. That would help. You learn. I know that we teach you about God back there pretty much weekly. The fruits of the Spirit. Someone has been paying attention. Amen. Okay, where else do we learn? Where are stories of God? Ashton. In the Bible, we can learn. You know you can read those by yourself. Did you know you don't have to wait for me to read those to you? Or Mr. Dave to read those to you? Wild. You can learn about God there. You can learn about God in songs that we sing, about his goodness, about his character, praising God. Yeah? Elijah. Yeah, absolutely. If we are loving God, God's going to love us back because he's a relational guy like that. And so we're going to continue to learn about him in that way. Like I said, memorizing scripture earlier, so we're not just having to guess about what it is that God is trying to say to us, about what it is that maybe God has to say for his people, but so that we know, so that we can compare it to what's happening in our thoughts and in our hearts. There are a lot of voices in our heads sometimes. Even as adults, for the adults, we hear mixed messages sometimes. A lot of them are disguised as truth. One of my favorites is you do you. Put yourself first. Do what's best for you. Because, listen, if you're not at 100%, you cannot be good for anybody else. And you're like, amen. Like, yes. And then maybe you take a second and you're like, wait. I'm not always at 100%. Even when I do things that like feel good and I enjoy, I'm not at 100%. Like, is that true? And maybe you have this question, so then you start to be like, wait, that was in like a really well done like meme on Facebook, so it looks like it's right. Maybe it's even presented by a nonprofit or by a woman I really respect. And so I'm pretty sure it's like, it sounds like something God would say, but I thought we like used to sing a song about like Jesus, others, then you. Like, how does that work in my brain? And yeah, like, if anyone comes against me, they're wrong. Like, I'm not sure it kind of sounds right, but it also, I just have this feeling like maybe it's not right. Like, it seems harsh. So when we have questions like this, we can turn to the heart of God. I have some slides. The first one is, these are questions that we can ask about a truth that we've seen to kind of measure it up to see, wait, where are we at with the heart of God? Okay, so the first one, do we have the first one? Does this word, this truth that someone's trying to share to me, help me to respect the Lord and depart from evil? Does it help me to say yes to Jesus and no to darkness? That one I'm going to say maybe not, because there's times I'm going to say no to Jesus. So that I can focus on me, right? So that one's a no. Okay, what's the next one? Does it increase my faith in my knowledge of God and understanding of the scriptures? Okay, if I'm putting myself first, putting everybody else absolutely last, does that increase my faith? No, not really. Does that increase my knowledge of the scripture? Well, I can't find it in scripture, so I guess not. Okay, what's the third one? Will my actions following these words be full of and bear those fruits of the Spirit? Okay, if I put myself absolutely first, am I always going to be more gentle and kinder and loving and good and full of self-control? Maybe sometimes, but 100% of the time, full of the fruit of the Spirit? I'm not sure. Okay, what's the next one? Will these words strengthen me with might so I can keep going no matter what? So yeah, like if I take time to focus on myself, get myself up to 100%, I don't care how long it takes. If I need to take a month vacation from my family, I'm getting to 100%. Then when I get back and they start to test me, right? Or my friends start to test me, or somebody flips me off while I'm driving, not nice. Am I still going to be strengthened with that might from that vacation so that I can keep going no matter what? Personally, no. All right, what's the last one? Does it cause me to experience joyfulness and thanksgiving to the Father? No, I think it's going to cause me to give joyfulness and thanksgiving to myself for, like, putting myself first, right? So when we have these kinds of questions of, like, wait, is that true? Like, should I be rude to somebody? Okay, well, does it help me respect the Lord? No. Does it help me increase my faith? No. If the answer to all these things is no, then what can we learn? That's not the voice of God. That's something else. And our goal is to keep the kingdom things, and let everything else be on its own. Go away. Fall away. Forget it. We're not about that life, right? I promise we're almost done. These sorts of questions, this searching for how to hear God's voice, this whole big conversation that's so much bigger than I could ever fit into a sermon, however long, it's a good and it's a really holy work. For you as parents to be striving on how to hear God's voice yourself, on how to teach your kids how to hear God's voice, on how to cultivate an environment in your home where the presence of God is welcome. Doesn't have to invade, is absolutely welcome. Like, the door is flung open for the Spirit of God to be at your dinner table, to reside over your kids while they're sleeping, to go with your kids before them when they go to school, to go before you when you go to your job, to go before you when you go to that doctor's appointment. To create this environment where you're actively every day waking up and saying, oh God, I want to hear your voice. I want to know you and be known by you. What do you want me to know? What do you want me to do? How can I influence my area, my kids, my family, my job for your glory? When we start to hear God's voice and we listen to it, we do what it says, we get to do really cool things. Like Simeon got to hold baby Jesus and pray blessing over him and dedicate him to God. How cool, right? And Anna, who was so listening to the Spirit of God, she got to know the baby was the Messiah as well, the one who would save her people. Mary got to teach Jesus how to walk and talk and play with his brothers and sisters. And she got to watch how he would then grow up and do the work and give the sacrifice to save her from her sins, to save his people from their sins. What kinds of cool things would you be able to do if you could hear the Spirit of God talking to you? It's not a question of, like, why isn't he talking to me? It's a question of, how can I listen well? How can I get to a place where I'm so in tune with the Spirit of God that when I can't see him, I just know, nope, that's not him. That's him. That's that voice I know. Because these things are in line with God's character and God's heart and God's desiring light for the world, right? All right, let's pray together. Jesus, thanks for today. Thanks for your heart, for your coming, and thanks for speaking to us. for leaning in with us, for walking with us, for going before, beside, hemming us in, and for the spirit that is so palpable. God, I pray that for each individual in this room, from the tiniest baby to the wisest among us, with as many days under their belt as possible. God, I pray for your presence to be so real and so close, and I pray for our desire to be so close to you. God, wake me up in the morning that I would see new mercies, that I would see your goodness, and that I would respond in prayer and hope and praise, saying, Jesus, you are good. I want more of you. Because that's what we want. As you continue leading us and guiding us in what it is you'd have us to know and what it is you want us to do, help us to learn the importance as well as the practice of listening to who you are so that we can respond and do the holy, good work you have called us to. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. Go. Have a great week.